and just those structures. And I have given you also some examples of three-dimensional crystal shadow lattices. Now, to finish that part, I would like to also mention two common lattices in nature. So the first one is the body center cubic lattice. So some common three-dimensional lattices. So the first one is the body-centered cubic lattice. Which we call the BCC lattice. And the BCC lattice can be described as a cubic lattice with two atoms in the basis. So if I draw a cube, this lattice has point on the corners of the cube and has also for each of the images of this cube has a point at the center of the cube. So this is the arrangement of the point in a body-centered cubic lattice. So it can be described as a cubic lattice with two atoms in the basis. And these two atoms are at the position D1. So this is the atom 1 and D2, which if my cube has a length here A, a lattice parameter A, then D2 is A over 2, A over 2, A over 2. So it's this point at the center of the cube. So with the primitive vectors of the cubic lattice that go along the side of the cubes, these three vectors, A1, A2, and A3, and these two atoms in the basis, I can generate the whole body center cubic lattice. Now, the question is this also a Bravais lattice or not?
Yes.
What? Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And the way, I mean, an example of primitive vector generate the whole body center cubic lattice is, for instance, I can take still A1 and A2, the same than in the cubic Bravais lattice, so this would be A1. A2 would be along this edge. And the third vector, well, I didn't draw things too well, but would be the vector that brings to the center of the cube, to the atom at the center of the cube. So A3 would be this vector that so with these three vectors, I would generate the full BCC lattice. This point obviously is 1 times A1, 1 times A2, 0 times A3. This point here is just 2 times A3, so 0, 0, 2. This point here can be obtained from this point by adding minus A1, so it's minus 1, 0, 2, and this one I can start from this and subtract A2, and this would be just minus 1, minus 1, and 2, for instance. So I can generate all points, yes?
To be clear, this is not a Bravais lattice, right?
Yes, it is.
It is?
Yes.
It is a Bravais lattice?
Yes, it is.
But earlier on you said we need one atom to define the whole clear base. Do you find it a Bravais lattice?
I mean, if you have a Bravais lattice, you can always find it's always a crystal structure with n equal 1, or even you can find larger n. So a Bravais lattice, can always be a crystal structure, but a crystal structure is not always a Bravais lattice. That is, you have cases where the minimum n is 2, of the number of atoms in the units in the basis that you can find. In this case, it can be described as a crystal structure, so with n equal 2, but it can also be described as a Bravais lattice, so it is a Bravais lattice. So a crystal structure is not always a Bravais lattice, but a Bravais lattice, if you have atoms that crystallize in a Bravais lattice, it's always a crystal structure. So
if this is a correct definition of a Bravais lattice, for example, if we have a lattice of n dimensions.
Okay, the way I described here, I described it as a crystal structure,
yes.
So with n equal 2. But now I'm telling you that it's also a Bravais lattice. Maybe I could have drawn this a bit better. But if you use these three vectors, that is A1, A2 along the side of the basis of the cube, and A3 that brings to this atom at the center of the cube, you can describe the full BBC lattice. So it's a Bravais lattice, because you have A1, A2, and A3, primitive vector that generates the whole lattice, and the number of atoms in the basis is 1 with these three primitive vectors. Okay? It's like the face, the centered square lattice which I showed the other day in two dimensions. I described this as a crystal structure with two atoms in the basis and starting from the primitive vector of the square lattice, but I showed that actually it is also a Bravais lattice. One can use different primitive vectors that are enough to generate the full lattice with n equal 1. So it was also a Bravais lattice. Here it's the same in three dimensions. Okay, is it?
Yeah. Yes. Can we say that Bravais lattice is the way to define all the points, but not necessarily to describe the cell? So here we are describing the cell.
Yes, last time I said that the crystal structure is a Bravais lattice plus a basis, that is, it's a Bravais lattice with a basis of atom attached to each point of the lattice. So yes. All right, you agree with this? Well, maybe I could have drawn this a little bit better. that. If drawing, so perhaps it is more clear. I don't want I need something that is quite. If I do this, I have here the diagonal. Okay, so this would be the center of the cube. So this is the atom that is on the corner. So if I take the three primitive vectors A1, A2, it's a bit, and A3, then I can generate all the lattice. This point is just this vector A1 plus A2. This point is just 2 times the A3 vector. This point is just this point minus A1. This point is just this point minus A2. So I'm generating, and this point is just this point plus A1, so I'm clearly generating the whole lattice with just these three vectors, so it is a Bravais lattice. So there are two descriptions. One as a crystal structure with two atoms in the basis, and one just as a Bravais lattice with one atom, a crystal structure with one atom in the basis, which is the red description. Now I can always find larger n. I could find also with 8 atoms in the basis, or it's always possible to define this as a crystal structure with a larger number of atoms in the basis. The difficult part is to reduce it. So in some case, a crystal structure, you can reduce it to n equal 4 atom in the basis, and that's it. Or you can reduce it to n equal 2, or you can even reduce it to n equal 1, and then it's a Bravais lattice. But it's not always possible to reduce it to n equal 1. All right? Okay. So the body center cubic lattice is a Bravais lattice. So the conclusion here is that BCC is a Bravais lattice, and this is shown by finding these three vectors, for instance, that generates the full lattice. This is the definition of the Bravais lattice. Three independent, linearly independent vectors that generate the full lattice with n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 and a3 with the n integral. Okay, so this is a common lattice in nature, and there is another one that is also common in nature, and it is the phase center cubic lattice. So our example of common lattice in nature is the phase center cubic lattice. FCC. found this is also a Bravais lattice. I will come back to this a bit later today. So the face-centered cubic lattice, the description starting from a cubic lattice is similar to the body-centered cubic lattice. That is, it is a cubic lattice with four atoms in the basis, and these four atoms are on the faces of the cube. So basically this one is half inside the cube and has the image here. So there is one atom overall on these faces, one atom on these faces, and one atom on these faces. So plus the one at the corner. So four atoms in the basis generate the face-centered cubic lattice starting from a cubic Bravais lattice. I will show later that this is also a Bravais lattice, but for the moment I just wanted to mention these two common lattices in nature. So for instance, iron, chromium, molybdenum, and tungsten crystallize in the BCC structure, and aluminum, gold, and silver crystallize in the FCC structure. So these are common lattices in nature. Okay, so that was to complete the part on Bravais lattices in three dimensions. Now I would like to introduce some other quantity, which is the packing, which is also useful to describe crystal structure, and in particular the concept of closed packing. So the next quantity I will introduce is the packing, and here we have in mind the packing of spheres in space. So we are going now to talk about packing, and we think about packing of spheres. The idea is backed to a first approximation. The atom can be viewed as spheres. And one is asking the question, how is the most efficient way to pack sphere in space in order to have the minimum amount of empty space? So this is the question. Now, if I start from two dimensions, so I'm looking at spheres on the ground, so in plane in the case of two dimensions. If I have some spheres and I try to pack them on the ground, okay, I will make them touch each other. So I will first go with a row of the sphere, and then to minimize the amount of empty space, if I want to add a row, I will just put it here so that I have the least amount of empty space when I put the spheres together. So on a plane, this is basically the arrangement that is optimal in terms of leaving the least amount of space between the sphere. And this corresponds to a triangular lattice for the center of the disk or the spheres. If I project on the plane. So this is basically the center of the disk here form a triangular lattice. And this is much more efficient. So my spheres have a given diameter A. If I have such spheres, if I pack them, I mean arrange them on the floor in this way, I have an efficient packing, whereas if I, for instance, pile them this way, on top, it's much less efficient. So in this case, it corresponds to a square lattice, the center of the sphere, and it's, one can see that it's less efficient as a packing than the first one. So there is a way to measure the efficiency of a packing, and this is what one calls the packing fraction. And I will define the packing fraction P as the surface of the occupied by the sphere. So the spheres have a given diameter A. So this is the surface occupied by a sphere, or a disk in this case, divided by the total surface per disk or per sphere. So if one, the first part is just a constant, it's the area of the disk, and the second part is if I continue this arrangement up to infinity, I can measure the amount of surface per total surface per sphere, which in this case would be just this area inside. This is the total surface per sphere, because in this unit I have this part of the sphere plus this part of the sphere plus this part of the sphere plus this part of the sphere, which give a full sphere. So if I want to calculate this ratio, the surface of the sphere occupied by the sphere is just pi times the radius square, so it's S, the surface occupied by the atom of the sphere is pi A over 2 square, and the surface, the total surface per atom or per sphere, this depends on the arrangement. this is in the triangular lattice. For instance, I will have the S total will be this surface, which corresponds to the total surface per atom. This is A, if my diameter of the sphere is A. And this is square root of 3 divided by 2A. So if I multiply the two, I will have the total surface here. So S total per atom in the case of the triangular lattice is A times square root of 3 divided by 2A. So this is for the triangular lattice. And in the case of the square lattice is just A square. The surface, total surface per atom is just A square. For the square lattice. Okay, any question up to here? Oh, it's all right, everybody sees it? Okay, all right, so now it's easy. I can just divide this by this to obtain the packing fraction. And in the case of the triangular lattice, this divided by this gives me P triangular lattice is equal to pi divided by 2 square root of 3. This is what remains. And in the case of the square lattice, P of the square lattice is just this, this divided by this, so it's just pi over 4. Okay?
I'm sorry. Are we taking the occupied area, even for the triangular lattice, as pi multiplied by a over 2 squared?
Yes. The,
shouldn't it be?
Okay. The packing fraction is measured as the surface of the disk, let's say, of the atom here, divided by the total surface of the system per atom. Oh. So this one is always the same. Is it's the surface of my my atom. I want to optimize the leave as little empty space as possible. So the higher this P, the better. If I had a square atom, I could even reach P equal 1, which would be the optimal.
Shouldn't we be calculating, like for example, when we are speaking about the on the lower packing, like the square packing, on the square packing we should be talking about this, if we take one square, we should compare the occupied area to the total area of a square.
Exactly.
Shouldn't we do exactly the same, but for the triangular on the
yes,
top one?
Yes, that's what we do.
But if we are talking about triangular, the occupied area is not pi multiplied by a over 2 squared. It should be less than that.
No, the sphere have always the same, or the atom have always the same surface. This is a constant, a.
Can I show you, like?
Yes. So here, my atom occupies this, which is pi a over 2, I mean, this is the surface of my atom divided by the surface per atom, total surface per atom. Here it's the same. I have my atom and basically the, yeah, in this surface you have exactly one atom.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Because
triangular.
No, no, not the triangular.
You're taking two triangles.
Yes,
oh, okay,
this
okay,
is
okay.
the surface
okay, okay.
of
I get
the.
It, I get it. Okay.
Okay.
I thought we were working in a
no,
single
no,
triangle.
No. It's this.
Okay.
This is this surface.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So given that. Square root of 3 is smaller than 2, so this is smaller than 4, so my P of the triangle is larger than the P of the square, that is, the triangular arrangement is better in terms of packing than the square. Arrangement. So P triangular lattice is larger than P square lattice, which means that one has a better packing in this case for the triangular lattice. Okay? So this is the packing, the measure of the packing. So now let me continue to three dimension. So this was for two dimension. The packing fraction, of course, one can. This gives also the packing fraction in three dimension. That is the volume occupied by the volume of a sphere divided by the total volume per sphere or per atom will give us the packing in three dimensions. So now I'm continuing in three dimensions. So I will start and I want to optimize the packing. So I will start from what I had in two dimensions, that is in two dimension, the best way to pack the sphere is by forming a triangular lattice. So I should draw this a bit better. All the spheres have to touch each other, and I place them. Okay. Well, okay. So it's a triangular lattice. And this is my first layer of atoms. And now I want to continue and find the best way to pack these spheres in three dimensions. So I can notice that I have basically two types of sides. Basically, I have a choice between centering the next layer of spheres on this type of site, empty site here. Or on this type of empty site. I have to choose one of the two in order to put the next layer. So if I choose the red, I will have my next layer that will be like this. And then I will have to center them also here. So my next layer will be here. Maybe I should draw it in red. So this is the next layer, which I have centered on one of the two possibilities, the red one, of the empty sides of the previous layer. Okay, it's and then we have also some other empty side of the previous layer here. Then we have empty side here. Okay. So if my first layer is on the A sides. So these are the A sites. My second layer is on the red sides, which I will call B. Sides. Okay? So, basically, if I start from the triangular arrangement with the A site occupied in my triangle, then if I want to have the best possible packing for the next layer, one possibility is to put them on the empty B sides, the red ones. So it's also a triangular arrangement. And this is optimal because I have occupied empty sides. But I would have another possibility which would be as good if I had chosen the green sides. This is another, the second type of empty side from my first layer. And if I had put my triangular arrangement for the second layer of spheres there, I would have something as good as the red one. Okay? So I have two possibilities to pack the best in the best possible way the second layer, either A, either B, or C. So C would correspond to these sides here. So I have three types of sides the A, the B, and the C, and that's it. Because once I put the second layer, the B sides, my empty sides of the B sides are either C or are A sides. So, okay, that's the way it is. So basically, in order to pack the spheres, I start from one layer in triangular arrangement, so this is my A layer. Then to pack in the best possible way, the second layer I have to occupy either B or C side, but of course not A side, the A sides are bad in terms of packing. So basically, and then once I have put the second layer, let's say I selected the B sides, then the third layer I have to go either to A sides or to C sides. The two will be as good, but I don't have to pack again in a B sides. So the algorithm to pack in the best possible way is that if the first layer occupies the A sides, the second layer must be different. So it has to be either B or C sides. Okay? And then if the second layer is on the B sides, then the third layer must be C or A. And so on. So in terms of packing, if I start from A, the second one has to be B or C. Then if I put the second one in B, the third one has to be in A or C, and so on. I have always to alternate, but I have always two possibilities. So this is the algorithm to pack in the best possible way spheres in three dimensions. And as you can imagine, there is an infinite number of sequences one can choose in order to do that. So, and they will all give the same packing fraction, the same efficient packing. So, one example is I could do A and A, B, C, A, B, A, C packing. It would be fine. This is one possible sequence. And this is the scheme leads to the most efficient packing in 3D. So most of the sequences I can imagine are not periodic. I mean, I have an infinite possibilities to do this, and most of the sequences are not periodic, but if I want a crystal structure, it has to be periodic. Crystal has to be periodic. So for crystal structure, I have to choose a periodic sequence. I have to have periodicity. I have to have a sequence that one repeats. So, for instance, I could have just A, B, A, B, A, B. Can I erase this? Yeah. So one possibility would be A, B, A, B, A, B. And so on. And this actually is what is called the hexagonal closed pact structure. So this sequence that gives the most efficient packing is corresponds to the hexagonal closed packed structure. Which we abbreviate HCP. And there are metals that crystallize in the HCP, like magnesium, for instance. But it is not a Bravais lattice, and I should have left the drawing to show that. One could see it from the drawing that I had before. So these are the A sites. And the HCP packing would be with the sphere like this, and the next one here. So one can see from here that this cannot be a Bravais lattice, because if this was a Bravais lattice, this vector here that brings from the first atom to the atom in the second layer should be a vector of the Bravais lattice, and therefore twice this vector should be also a vector of the Bravais lattice. But twice this vector will bring in terms of projection on this site, the C site, and we know this is not part of this lattice, because we have A, B, A, B, A, B sequence, so we never reach this. So it cannot be a Bravais lattice.
So the A, B, C, A, B, C sequence would be a Bravais lattice.
Yes, exactly. But not A, B, A, B, A, B, which is the closed hexagonal closed packed lattice. So this is not a Bravais lattice. However, if I do A, B, C, A, B, C, and so on. This is this will be a Bravais lattice, and actually, surprise, this is the face center cubic lattice. Yeah. So ABC, ABC is actually the face centered cubic FCC arrangement. And this is a Bravais lattice. This turns out to be a Bravais lattice. And this is also the most efficient way, as good as the hexagonal closed packed lattice, the most efficient way to pack spheres. So these are closed packed structure, and with similarly good efficiency in terms of having the sphere packed. Now, I told you this, I have not proven it. I will just try to show you that this makes sense, and I will discuss a little bit more the face-centered cubic lattice. So now we will spend a little bit of time on the face-centered cubic lattice, which is an important lattice. As I mentioned, this is a common lattice in nature. So let's try some drawing now. I'm going to focus on this FCC lattice. So the FCC lattice, the first description, as I mentioned, it's a cubic lattice with four atoms in the basis, and this this corresponds to a cube with atoms apart from the corner on each face of the cube. So I'm going to draw that. So this is the cube. Let's try to do this way. Okay, so I have atoms on the corners of my cube. And also on the faces of the cube. So these are on the corner. On the faces, I will do them a little bit smaller, just to for the drawing. So here on the front face, then here I will have one also on the top face, and on the back face here, I will have another one here. So this is the one on the front face. This is one on the side face, and then I have one on the back face there, which should be here. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, I forgot the one on the bottom face also, there's one here. So these are the atoms that one has in the FCC arrangement, focusing just on this cube unit. And the first description of the FCC lattice is that this is a cubic lattice, a cubic Bravais lattice, with a basis with a basis of four atoms. And these atoms are, in my drawing, D at the position D1, which is the origin, 0, 0, 0. So this is my atom 1. D2, if the, my cube has a side A, will be A over 2, A over 2, 0. So this is the atom which is on the bottom face here, 2. D3, which is equal to 0, A over 2, A over 2. So this is the atom that is on this face here, the YZ plane, in the YZ plane. And the fourth one is at A over 2, 0, A over 2. So this one will be in the front in the front face plane face here. So this is the atom 4. So the four atoms which I have in the basis are this one. This one, this one, and this one. The number 4 is in this front face. Okay. So all right. So this is my first description. So if I have the conventional primitive vector of the cube, that is A1, A2, and A3, plus these four atoms in the basis, I can generate the full FCC lattice. I mean, obviously all the atoms at the corner of the cube can be generated from the atom 1, with the primitive vectors, using the primitive vectors, and then I can generate this atom from this one, also with a primitive vector, the A2 vector. This one goes to this one with the vector, a translation of the vector A1, and the same, this one to, goes to this one, and also this, the yeah, okay. I guess it's pretty clear one can generate the full lattice. So this one, this is a crystal, is seen as a crystal structure, so a cubic Bravais lattice with four atoms in the basis. Now the second description, which will be a Bravais lattice description, is that I can also find some primitive vector that generate this lattice with just one atom in the basis. And so the second description is that this is a Bravais lattice. FCC Bravais lattice with, for instance, as primitive vector, one can choose A1, is equal to d2. So I will choose for a1 this vector. A2 is equal to D3, and A3 is equal to D4. So here I will choose as primitive vector A1, A2 that goes to the atom 3, and A3 that goes to this atom 4. So this is A3. So if I choose as primitive vector these three vectors bringing to the atom on the face of the cube, then I can generate the full lattice, FCC lattice. So to show this, maybe it's not so obvious from the picture that one can generate all the atoms in this lattice, but basically I have already the four atoms in red, and if I show that with linear combinations, with integer linear combination of A1, A2, and A3, I can regenerate the three vector of the cubic lattice, and I'm done, because from these three vector, if I can also use the primitive vector of the cubic lattice, I go to all other points on my lattice. So what I'm going to show here is that with these three primitive vector of the Bravais FCC lattice, I can, with sum and differences of this vector, regenerate the three primitive vector of the cubic lattice. And if I can do that, then it's easy to show I generate the full lattice, BCC lattice, with translation, I mean, with these vectors. So with these three primitive vector, I generate already all the points in red, or the atom in red in my drawing there. And now, in addition, I can show that with sums and differences, of this three vector A1, A2, and A3, I can obtain this gives me back the three vector A1 cubic, the primitive vector of the cubic lattice, A2 cubic, and A3 cubic. And this is just, this is easy, that is, one can show that A1 cubic is just my A1 here plus A3 minus A2. Basically, so A1, A2, and A3 are these three vectors, okay? D2, D3, and D4. So if I do A1 plus A3 minus A2 I obtain A, 0, because I have A over 2 minus A over 2, and here I obtain D2 plus D4 minus D3, I obtain 0. So I obtain A, 0, 0, which is just this vector that is the first vector of the cubic lattice along the edge of the cubic lattice. So indeed, I'm obtaining this vector, which is the primitive vector of the cubic lattice with a sum and difference of these three vectors. The second one, A2 cubic, I can obtain it as A1 plus A2 minus A3. So if here I do A1 plus A2 minus A3, I obtain 0, A, and again 0, which is indeed this vector here, the primitive conventional primitive vector of the cubic lattice. And the third one, A3C cubic, it's just A2 plus A3 minus A1. If I do A2 plus A3 minus A1, I obtain 0, 0, and A, which is indeed the third primitive vector of the cubic lattice. So with this, basically, I generate all points of my lattice, because I had already the four atoms in red. Now, if I can add the use the primitive vector of the cubic lattice as combination sum and difference of these three vectors, I can generate all atoms of the lattice by just I mean, from this one I can go to this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one. From this one I can go to this one, from this one I can go to the one in the back of my face, and from this one I can go to the one. So I can generate with integer multiple of my three primitive vector all the Bravais lattice, and therefore I have all points of the lattice, and therefore I have a Bravais lattice. Okay? So the face center cubic lattice is indeed a Bravais lattice. So this was the first point to show that this is a Bravais lattice. Now, to see the correspondence between this hexagonal packing, ABC, ABC, and the FCC structure, one has to basically, the correspondence is that if I take the diagonal of the cube as the axis C, perpendicular to the plane of atoms of my A, B, C hexagonal arrangement of atoms. So this is in the diagonal of the cube here. It corresponds essentially to the C axis of the hexagonal arrangement, or the triangular arrangement of my atoms in the plane. So if basically what I'm going to show is that here I have the A layer of atoms, here I have the B layer of atoms, here I have the C layer of atoms, and again here the A layer of atoms. So all these atoms are in the same plane. This is because, okay, these are at the corner of my face, my front face, and this atom 4 here is in this on this line, which is the diagonal of the face. So these three atoms are on the same line. This atom here on the back is also going through the atom here on the face of the bottom face of the bottom plane here. So also these three atoms are on the same line, and similarly here, this atom, and this one are on the same line. This is the diagonal here of this face, which is in the back here. So all these atoms here, this one, are in the same plane. Okay? So this would correspond to the layer of A atoms, this to the layer of B atoms, and this similarly, I have these three atoms on the same line here, which is the diagonal of the face. These three atoms are on the same line, the diagonal here of this face, and also these three atoms are on the same line, so all these atoms are in the same plane, which corresponds to the C layer or C plane. And here this is equivalent, and going back to the A layer. So this is my packing ABC, ABC, my stacking of the triangular arrangement of atoms in the layers. I mean, it's a different question to prove it, but at least one can see that it makes sense. And this is the correspondence between the FCC lattice and the hexagonal ABC-ABC packing of the atom which I showed you before. Okay? More or less, you can see the correspondence. All right. And just the last thing, to add on this. So, as I mentioned, the diagonal of the cube corresponds to the C axis of the hexagonal ABC, ABC type of lattice. So, if I look along the diagonal of the cube, this corresponds to the hexagonal C-axis, the C-axis of an hexagonal structure. And now if I look along this axis, so this is my C-axis that points perpendicular to the plane of the blackboard, then my A atoms, the atoms in this layer, if I look at the projection, will be located here, and it's going to form a triangular lattice. There will be here. So the white points will correspond to the A atoms, the atom of the first layer. The second layer will be positioned like this for the projection. So this will be the B layer. And the C layer will be essentially here in terms of projection. So this is what one would see looking perpendicular, looking parallel to the C axis. This would be the projection one would see from this view. Okay, so this is for the FCC lattice and class correspondence to the closed packed hexagonal ABC. Okay, now I will introduce some other quantity, which is the coordination number, which is also useful to describe crystal structure. So can I erase this? Okay. So we are producing now the coordination number. And we are talking about coordination number of a point in a Bravais lattice. So coordination number. This is the number of nearest neighbor to a lattice point. Number of nearest neighbor to a lattice point. So let's look at some of these lattices, the simple cubic lattice first. So if I draw the points of a simple cubic lattice, so the points are here. Then I have some continuation of this lattice. So how many nearest neighbors does a point of the lattice have?
Six.
Yeah. So in a simple cubic lattice, there are six nearest neighbor, so if this is the side, the lattice parameter A, then I have six nearest neighbor at a distance A in the simple cubic lattice. How many second nearest neighbor to a lattice point? So this is the coordination number, but how many second nearest neighbor would we have in a simple cubic lattice? So the second nearest diagonal of the diagonal. 12, yes. 4 in this plane, 4 in this plane, and 4 in this plane. So 12 second nearest neighbor. And this is at square root of 2a, distance of square root of d. And to finish, how many third nearest neighbor does each point have? This is along the diagonal of the cube. No. So how many cube around the point?
8.
So 8.
Oh yeah, 8.
8. Yeah. Third nearest neighbor. And these are along the diagonal of the cube, so it's at root 3 of root square root of 3a for the distance. Okay, so this is for the simple cubic lattice which has a coordination of 6 nearest neighbor. Now let's look at the BCC lattice. So the BCC lattice has points on the corner of the cube and also at the center of the cube. So how many first nearest neighbor does the point have? 8. So 8 nearest neighbor. And this is at square root of 3 over 2, half of the diagonal of the cube. So at the distance of square root of 3 over 2a. So this is the coordination number in a BCC lattice. And how many second nearest neighbor does each datum have?
6.
6, yes, these are the one at distance a. So yes, there are 6 second nearest neighbor at distance a. So this is for the BCC lattice, and finally FCC lattice. So there we have atoms or points at these points at the corner and fan on each of the faces of the cube. So yeah, also on the back face here. And on the front face here, I have one. So it's a bit more complicated, but how many first nearest neighbor do we have? They are on the faces. If I look at around this point, they are on the center, at the center of the faces. How many first nearest neighbor?
12.
Yeah. There are 4 in this plane, 4 in this vertical plane, and 4 in this vertical plane. So 12 nearest neighbor, and they are at the distance square root of 2 divided by 2a, which is half the diagonal of the face of the cube. And how many second nearest neighbor?
Six.
Six. These are the ones that are along the edges of the cube. So six second nearest neighbor, and they are at a distance A. So the coordination number for the FCC lattice is 12, which is consistent with the fact that this is a close-packed structure. So this is the best piling of C, and one can expect also the largest number of nearest neighbor, or the largest coordination number. So to summarize, FCC has the largest number of nearest neighbor or coordination number. FBCC, the second largest. And simple cubic is the worst in terms of packing, or in terms of nearest neighbor number, is the third largest. It has only six nearest neighbor. So now, as homework, I would like you to calculate the packing of these three Grave lattice, simple cubic, BCC, and FCC. So the homework is to calculate the packing fraction of the FCC, BCC, and simple cubic lattices. And if you do it right, you should find that this is consistent. Of course, the FCC should have the largest packing, and for the other two, it should be consistent also with the coordination number, the order. So I will finish here, and this is homework for next time. Any question up to here? All clear. Okay, thank you.